This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Today on Dreamland, we're going to have one of the true great, great researchers into the lost past. He hasn't been on the show in so long that I don't think either of us wants to bother to say how long it has been, but it's been a while, too long, because Chris Dunn is truly one of the greats. He is to give you an idea of his background, he's a retired aerospace engineer. He's published dozens of articles on ancient technology. He's appeared on the History Channel, the Travel Channel, the Discovery Channel, the Learning Channel, and many others. He's the author of the classic and terribly important book, The Giza Power Plant, and also Lost Technologies of Ancient Egypt. We have interviewed about both of those, and I welcome you, Chris Dunn, to Dreamland.
Thank you, Whitley. It's nice to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure to be here. I want to go back to the beginning. What drew your interest to the Great Pyramid in the first place?
Actually, it was a book that I picked up at a bookstore. It just kind of jumped out of the shelves to me. And it was Peter Tompkins' Secrets of the Great Pyramid, which was a seminal book on pyramid studies. And reading that book, the craftsman engineer in me resonated with the information that was being provided, because he was providing technical information. The people that he introduced in his book, who had done research in Egypt, seemed to have strong technical backgrounds, and so it was a pleasure to read. But as I was reading, there was something that I started to dawn on me, and that was that there's a lot of people out there that question the tomb theory, and they raise very, very valid points as to whether it is actually the truth. I ultimately concluded that the questions were valid, that the tomb theory is very weak. And when you consider the size of the Great Pyramid, and, you know, it weighing almost 6 million tons, the precision with which it was built, exacting precision, where the joints are so tight that you couldn't even slip a piece of paper between them, on a lot of them, and then also the schematics of the interior design and architecture suggested that to me that it was actually a machine, only a machine that was on the scale of acres, and it had the precision of a machine. And so, with that conclusion, the question then was, well, if it was a machine, what was it? What was the machine doing? And I ultimately landed on the concept of it being a power plant, and and that each feature within the Great Pyramid performed a particular function, and that was how I approached it, more like a reverse engineering project, where say a company will bring a machine into their lab. They'll tear it apart. They'll examine every part of it to try to determine how it works. And in the case of the Great Pyramid, I was basically, you could consider me like a mechanic who comes across a machine in the middle of the jungle or something like that, and is trying to figure out what the machine did. And in order to do that, I had to draw on a lot of expertise and knowledge that I didn't have. And so over the years, I consulted with engineers, physicists in various fields, mechanical fields, electrical, microwave, you know, all these different specialties, civil engineers. I consulted with those aerospace engineers and acoustic engineers. And then, you know, all of these specialties provided a little clue or some information that I found valuable in trying to explain certain features. So ultimately, the Giza Power Plant was published in 1998. That was 21 years after the idea first came to me. And that 21 years was a bit of a struggle because it wasn't like I wasn't looking for a publisher. I had a manuscript. I was shopping it around. I was receiving many rejection slips, and they piled up over the years. But ultimately, the Barbara Han Clow of Bear & Company saw value in it. And I think against recommendations from her associates, she signed the book, and it was published. So I'm just here because of all the very, very smart, clever, kind people who have helped me along the way. And it's like, you know, the tail end of my journey on the planet Earth. I feel only gratitude that I've been able to benefit from them.
It was decided that it must be a tomb back in the 19th century, I believe. Yes.
Yes, I think it was. That's been pretty much what you might call the accepted wisdom.
But the science has advanced fantastically in the 20th century, and yeah. You never really went into the Egyptological community, because there's no there anymore. They're still in the 19th century. They have never looked at any of this in any way except that. And I just can't understand that. Why does this community not keep up with modern scientific advances that cast the pyramid clearly in a whole different light?
That's a good question. I mean, I don't know the exact answer. I can only assume, but I think that that would be true of Western Egyptologists, not necessarily Egyptian Egyptologists, because the tide is turning in Egypt, and there are many Egyptian Egyptologists who are now looking at the lost technologies of ancient Egypt and seeing value in them, And why shouldn't they? Because essentially what it points out to people is that their ancestors were more advanced than what we've given them credit for. Much more advanced. Maybe in some ways more advanced than we are. We don't know. But it does open the question that young people in Egypt, especially engineers, are tuning into this lost technologies. And there are Egyptian engineers now. One is named Ahmed Adli, and he's a fine Egyptian engineer and has produced a YouTube channel with many different videos, and it's in Arabic, and the Arabic speaking world just keep demanding more. They absolutely love the content that they're being provided about their past.
And he also provided some other content, that is to say, the forward to your book.
Yes, he did. Yes, and thank you for pointing that out. Yes. And that's an interesting connection that there. I'm glad you brought that up, Whitley, because it's important.
Well, listen, I know it's important, and because I know it's important, I also know that before we get into it, it's time to take a brief break. We'll be right back. This is just a quick reminder to let you know Chris Dunn will be with us in the video chat room on April the 6th at 10 a.m. Pacific time. That's Saturday, April the 6th, 10 a.m. Pacific time, live to answer your questions. Of course, you have to be a subscriber to enter the chat room. So if you're not a subscriber and want to talk to Chris, why not subscribe? It's a wonderful place to be, unknowncountry.com. Don't forget the date, April 6th, 10 a.m. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now. And join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Chris Dunn. We were just getting into the story of the foreword by Ahmed Adli of his book. Chris's new book is Giza, the Tesla Connection. His website is gizapower.com, and it's incidentally an incredibly cool website and very worth going to. Okay, let's continue where we were left off, Chris.
Yes. After the Giza Power Plant was published, I engaged with some discussions on message boards, and then I kind of got a feel for what the level of interest or willingness to review the information that I put out by academia. Egyptologists, historians, and so it became very clear to me that I was like I hit a brick wall. There's no way they were going to accept it or even look at it seriously. So at that point, I decided that I would appeal to the Egyptians. Particularly Egyptian engineers, because they would have the most to gain from this information being more widely known. And so I put an appeal in my book and challenged Egyptian engineers because to actually inspect their own artifacts in the same way that I did, to verify what I had discovered for themselves, not just take my word for it, but to do their own measurements. And then Ahmed Adli was a Egyptian engineer who took that to heart and did just that, to follow my path and to see if what I was writing about had any truth to it. And he concluded that it did. What I was saying was true, and he verified in one site, particularly the Serapeum, where they have these collections of huge granite boxes that are crafted to a high order of precision, and many other artifacts, such as the Ramses statues, the vases, many other different artifacts in Egypt. And so his work became very popular. And he had, it also showed an interest in the Giza power plant theory, and presented his theory, that theory, to a physicist at Cairo University, Dr. Ashraf Shabini, who claimed that it makes sense that the tomb theory is essentially doesn't really fit the evidence, and that an engineering systems approach to the concept of the pyramid being a power plant makes more sense. So that was very positive. And that work, that interest and that development in Egypt continues. It just hasn't stopped. So while, you know, you mentioned why aren't Egyptologists a little more progressive in their acceptance of new information? Most Western Egyptologists are not, it seems. But Egyptian Egyptologists are, with some exceptions, I would say. There are still those in Egypt who hold power, but who are sticking with the traditional theory of the pyramids being tombs.
Yeah, they're sort of colonized in a way, I think, because Egyptology, Western Egyptology, is very Eurocentric in the sense that it looks upon everything that has to do with the past as being primitive and simple compared to the modern world, and it will ignore anything that suggests anything else. And they don't understand that, you know, we left the colonies a long time ago because they're still in them.
Yeah, I mean and that is another aspect of why this information is being accepted by the Egyptians, is that one reason they're looking at my work is because I don't detract from their culture and giving credit to other cultures. So I don't talk about Atlanteans or aliens, and I talk about the indigenous people in that area at the time. So if you look at the history of Egypt, you'll see that they have been invaded and colonized several times. You have the French, the English, Germans. I mean, they're having their artifacts spirited away in the dead of night, and transported to museums around the world. They are arguing strenuously for the British Museum to send the Rosetta Stone back to them, because they, you know, that is a treasured artifact for them. And then the bust of Nefertiti in the Berlin Museum is a treasured artifact that they want back. Whether they get it back eventually, I don't know. But still, it is that kind of mentality that you referred to, Whitley, and it's you know, nationalism or chauvinism, that when you are stronger, a stronger nation, then you have power over a group of people. You are, and then you look at how they perform work and what they produce. It seems like they can't move past that and see that these things could not be produced with the tools that are in the archaeological record or in the ancient Egyptians' toolbox, be impossible to actually make those artifacts. And they can't see past that and look and recognize that they had to have been a much higher and more capable civilization at that time. Certainly, you know, our civilization is supported by specialties. The few actually support the many with the devices, technologies, and things like that. And that's what that's why we can live comfortably. Sorry?
No, I said, I just agreed. Yes, go ahead.
Yes. And so, yeah, we have to recognize that, you know, none of us have all the information. Sometimes people all across the world to solve a problem, and so I think the way we have looked at a native people and in these, you know, these really ancient civilizations, and the way we look at them and the way we've treated them has been extremely disrespectful, and also focus on self-interest or what they can gain from it.
Well, exactly. Now, I want to get back to the period itself. The pyramid, in fact, I think most of, maybe all of the pyramids were built during what's known as the Old Kingdom, and something happened that caused the collapse of what on every measure had been a very stable society. And there is apparently, some have theorized that the explosion of Santorini, I believe the Greek island of Santorini, caused a tremendous upheaval in that it would have coated the whole area with a massive cloud of ash and dust. And I think the biblical references to this catastrophe are quite famous. And could that have had something to do with the loss of what looks to me like a very powerful science that was existing before that?
Oh, absolutely. If not Santorini, but certainly some other cataclysmic event that caused upheaval in the planet, disrupted the entire civilization. There was an extinction event. I mean, we know that those events have happened in our history. The question is how far back do you go? And now I think with the new information coming out about the Younger Dryas impact, and then there are other cataclysmic events. It answers so many questions when you consider that. That the Earth actually suffered an extinction event, and ours could too. You know, it's just like it's the natural order of things. You know, that occasionally you have a visitation from a very large object that strikes the planet, and shakes things up.
Or a huge solar flare could have done it too. You know, incidentally, right now we are at the point of one of the 11-year, every 11-year cycle, there's the sun's magnetic field reverses. And during that period, there can be great solar flares, and we're absolutely not prepared. If another great solar flare occurred, it could conceivably really wipe out our civilization.
I mean, it's
fragile. Civilizations are fragile.
Yes, I mean, we're not immortal, that's for sure.
No.
And history proves that. And so depending on how far back you go, where there was one that would bring a civilization like in Egypt to its knees, it would be, I would say, tens of thousands, 10 or 20, 30,000 years earlier than the given date for the building of the pyramids, which was around 2500 BC. But the if you go back further back than that, then you can find an explanation for why so much that must have existed to support that civilization no longer exists.
Would that be why there are no, there's no tools, because they're were from so far in the past, they're gone?
Yes, I mean, if you go on a building site, any building site that's you know, it's been built and it's been functioning for several years, you don't find the tools that were used to build it. And so if you're going to be looking around the Great Pyramid for the tools that built it, you're not going to find them. So just after the construction, the tools would have been hauled off, held somewhere else, used it at another site. When the cataclysm hit, who knows what happened to them, you know?
We're going to take another break. And when we come back, I want to ask Chris how old this civilization actually is and what cataclysm he's talking about, because I don't think we're talking about the same cataclysm. So we'll be right back. This is just a quick reminder to let you know Chris Dunn will be with us in the video chat room on April the 6th at 10 a.m. Pacific time. That's Saturday, April the 6th, 10 a.m. Pacific time, live to answer your questions. Of course, you have to be a subscriber to enter the chat room. So if you're not a subscriber and want to talk to Chris, why not subscribe? It's a wonderful place to be, unknowncountry.com. Don't forget the date, April 6th, 10 a.m. I'd like to tell you a wonderful story. It's a story about my wife, Anne. She passed on in 2015, an hour after she died. She began to come back. Now she's with us, and you can learn more about this and what it means to you and what it can mean to you, so much more than you may think. Get the Afterlife Revolution. Get it today. You can read it on Kindle as a book. You can listen to me reading it as an audiobook. It's a beautiful journey into a new way of understanding death and life. And yes, afterlife. There's a reason that Dr. Gary Schwartz, one of the great afterlife investigators in the world, says it's among the most convincing cases he has ever encountered. Afterlife Revolution. Don't miss it. This is a brief excerpt from an interview with two contactees who had an 11-day close encounter experience and are now willing to speak about it, really, for the first time. To hear their whole interview and many others, subscribe to unknowncountry.com. Here's the excerpt. Did you see the man's face?
Yes, actually, that one is very clear to me. It was kind of longish, and he didn't look completely human, but because he had very, very thin hair, almost non-existent, but he was young, I believe that it was kind of blonde. And he was very tall, like at least 6 feet. And he was so thin that he looked kind of strange.
And what happened then?
Well, he wanted me to go with him, or to stay with him. He wanted me to stay with him on the ship. And I'd been married for 6 months, and I wasn't about to go running off to stay on the ship.
Now, surely you want more. You must want more. And there is more. Not only this contactee interview, but many others, many of them just as extraordinary, on unknowncountry.com, plus everything else that we offer, my audio books, the meditations, the talks on the key, William Henry's wonderful revelation show and its entire run, and Strieber's brilliant and magical mysterious powers, and so much more. Hours and hours of listening pleasure. Learn from the meditations on the site. Really learn, because they're real and they're valuable. Subscribe to unknowncountry.com right now. Go to unknowncountry.com. Click on the subscribe tab. We are running very low on new subscribers now, and that should not be. It should not be happening. So you do it. You go there and you do it today. We're talking to Chris Dunn, Giza, the Tesla Connection, his website, GizaPower.com, Acoustical Science and the Harvesting of Clean Energy. And we're going to get into all of that in a few minutes. But right now, I want to go back in time, Chris, to the beginnings of Egyptian civilization as you see it, because the pyramid is obviously the work of a highly advanced technological and social culture. In other words, there were a lot of people involved, a lot of engineers. This was not something done by a very primitive, just recently post-hunter-gatherer civilization. So tell us about that civilization and when it was and what happened to it as you understand it.
Yes, I should state, though, at the outset that my position has always been that I'm not the person to decide when the pyramids were built or who built them. So the when and the who is not within my purview. What is the how and the why. In other words, how were these artifacts and structures constructed, and for what reason? So really, if you look at it from a strictly engineering perspective, I don't care so much when or who built the Great Pyramid. My focus is on how it was built and why. So the that may seem like a cop out, and it probably is, because I am definitely, it's less ambiguous when you're talking about engineering than it's when you're trying to pin it down to a point in history, maybe what, 5,000 years, 10,000, 15, 20, 30. Ultimately, I mean, right now and in my book I say that, you know, if the history of Egypt needs to be rewritten, then it's the Egyptians that need to rewrite it, not outsiders. And, you know, unfortunately, in the past, it has been outsiders that yes. have written Egyptian history for us.
Well, that's very true. And they've written it in the way we discussed before, with the assumption that it was always very primitive. But when you look at the production of what it produced, it was not primitive. In fact, most of what it produced couldn't be created today. And it's, I know not just the pyramid, but many of the temples and the other artifacts are beyond belief. And yet we touched briefly on tools previously. And in all of this, there's not even a cartouche or anything that describes the tools.
Right. There's you know, that's one of the things. If you go to a you know, around a city, one of our cities, you don't see engravings on walls where you see a CNC machine or a milling machine or a lathe or something like that. They're generally not the subject of fine art. People will, you know, make sculptures, reliefs of people rather than objects. so that we don't see them in their reliefs, in their artwork, doesn't surprise me. We don't see the tools in them.
We don't see them in the ground either. And if you go forward to the Roman era, to the Ptolemaic era, tools of various kinds and papyri and so forth begin to appear in profusion, but not earlier, not when it was Egypt.
Right.
After it ceased to become Egypt, that sort of thing began to, you know, the same sort of artifacts that you find all over the ancient world. Only some of them in Egypt better preserved because it's so dry.
Yeah. And the answers to those questions, I think, I don't think we have them.
No.
I'm not sure if we will ever have them. We can only speculate. The only thing that we have are the imprints or the marks that the tools left in the igneous rock and the sedimentary rock that they were carving. And combining those tool marks and looking at also the geometry and precision with which these objects were crafted, then you can't conclude anything else other than they had to have had machine tools to create them. And, you know, this conversation that we're having today is not new. William Flinders Petrie, in his book, he described the existence of lathes, machine tools in ancient Egypt that would have been necessary to craft the artifacts that he was studying. So, and that was back in 1883. So the you know, the idea that the ancient Egyptians or the creators of these objects were, you know, blessed with machine tools is not a new idea. It's just not accepted by Egyptologists. And then, you know, I came along and I'm afraid I'm a bit of a troublemaker, and I started to push on that button, and I think, you know, the Egyptologists kind of hardened their position on it and just dismiss it out of hand while heaping mockery on Chris Dunn.
it's a closed culture with its own language and arts and its own meaning, and it is very self-defensive.
They behave rather angrily when people disagree with them for some reason. I mean, Robert.
You know, my dad was a very wise man, and he was an attorney and had been in all kinds of things in his life. And he used to say, Whitley, never forget, when people get mad, it's usually because they're wrong.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's it. That's why I don't get mad.
Neither do I, of course.
Right. I would love, well, I don't like being wrong. I've been wrong too many times, but I've always corrected my mistakes, or tried to, when I knew about them. And nobody's perfect. And so if somebody points something out to me that I think is a value and I need to correct a mistake, I will do it. And I find that in my book, as you know, I corrected a few mistakes that I had made in my first book. And
yes.
And so, you know, that, and 20 years from now, somebody may correct the mistakes I made in the Tesla connection.
I want to go back to the tools for a minute, because and we're going to lead into the power plant theory and your latest thinking from here. Because the absence of devices that seem relevant in the archaeological record seems to me to be explained in the book. Would that be fair to say, or am I going down the wrong path here?
I think there are reasons that make sense for why these things disappear. But as far as actual proof, it's a hypothesis, you know. When you look at the situation, the whole situation, you have an observation, an artifact. You make an observation of the artifact. I concluded that there had to have been machine tools to create this artifact, and I produce measurements to show what how precise the artifact is, its geometry, et cetera, et cetera. And so that is actually circumstantial evidence to say, well, you know, they had the action of a machine tool. And because the only thing that I have to make that argument is the object that was made by the machine tool. Now, the question then becomes in many people's minds, well, where are the machines? And so for those who are, you know, kind of orthodox, they're not willing to consider the implications of what accepting such an idea would mean, because basically if they accept that idea that machine tools existed in prehistory and these things indeed were, you know, the civilization was much more advanced, then all the history books would have to be rewritten. And and they would have to say that they were wrong. And that human nature seems to dictate that people will avoid that or be resistant to it. Sometimes their whole life, they will be resistant to admitting that they were wrong. Now, when it comes to the Egyptians, though, their motives are a little different, and I understand those. And that is that they're elevating their ancestors on the world stage in terms of the progress of technologies, the progress of science. And they're beginning to see and recognize their true place in the world. So, how long this revolution will go on? I mean, it's more of a, I think right now it's more of a grassroots revolution, because when I started out, there weren't many people with my background who had computers, let alone were entering message boards and discussing things. But now there are thousands, if not millions, of technical type people, craftsmen, engineers, who are finding their voice online and strongly supporting the nature of these artifacts and claiming for them to have been made by machines. So it is a more of a grassroots. Eventually it will percolate up, I should imagine.
There's a few things that do exist in terms of possible technological artifacts, like the Dendera light bulb, and it's off your subject, I know, but you've probably looked at that relief, and what do you think of it? I mean, do you think it could be an indication of the existence of an ability to handle electrical energy?
Well, I think it's a fascinating relief. You know, it's a fine example of the natural order of things when it comes to who writes history. And generally, history is written by the victors, or it's written by those who got there first, right? And so the people who got there first at the Dendera Temple and interpreted those reliefs, they have their cosmology, their basically interpreted from a symbolic perspective. And that interpretation is held. You know, when you have those who have come later with more of a technological persuasion, in other words, they interpret the world around them from a technologist perspective, and they look at the same relief, they interpret it differently, but their voice is dismissed, because the voice that came first has more power and authority. And really, at the end of the day, there's only one way to prove whether what the images are supposed to represent, and that is to actually interview the people who crafted them onto the wall, and have them testify as to their intention. You know.
Well, that's right. Well, of course, with the ancient Egyptians, can you be absolutely sure? Because I remember, where is that those depictions of apparent modern devices are on the rafter of one of the temples? So maybe it'll turn out that time travel is possible, and they did it.
But I mean, you know, there's been a lot of talk about the what they call the Dendera light bulb, and also the Abydos helicopter. I had taken some close up images of that. I was using a telephoto lens on my camera. And you can definitely see that is a combination of different reliefs. I think they call it a palimpsest, where one relief is covered over with some kind of a gypsum or
another relief,
right, and then then carved to represent something else. So you know, it's uncanny the way it looks, and people get all excited about it. I really don't get that excited about that myself.
Well, I have a lot of problems with practical problems with believing that time travel is even possible. The only way we could travel into the future would be if we accelerated to something close to the speed of light, and then returned, because our time in the ship we accelerated would be moving much more slowly than the time on Earth. So if you went, I don't want to go down that road. I've never really talked about it on the show, and we should actually at some point, but there's never been a book written about that possibility. Okay. So anyway, that's neither here nor there. I think it's time to get into Nikola Tesla, which is, of course, the core and heart of this whole new story that you're telling, the acoustic science and the harvesting of clean energy. And it's an important story because obviously there's something we're missing about here, this energy. But, you know, we've come to the end of the free part of the of the show, and we'll go on with the subscribers, and we're going to get very deeply into the Pyramid Tesla connection. Free Dreamlanders, I would like to thank you very much for being with us. I hope you have found this discussion as interesting as I have. And Chris Dunn's book, again, is Giza, the Tesla Connection. His website is gizapower.com.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.